heard from the Lord today, and as I contemplated not just what the Lord would have me to say to you, but as I contemplated the season, this season of Advent, where we celebrate the coming of the Christ child, the Lord drew my attention to two portions of Scripture, one found in the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter number 1, and I will be reading verses 18 to 24, and then we will jump over to the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter number 1 as well, and I will be reading verses 26 through 32, and then verse 38. First, the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter number 1, and I will be reading verses 18 to 24, and then stick a pen there. We will go to Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 32, and then verse 38. When you are there, please signify by standing in reverence and respect for the holy word of God. Lift your Bibles in the air. Let the enemy know that you came packing. And repeat after me, this is my Bible. I can have what it says I can have. I can do what it says I can do. And I can be who it says I can be. Today I'm going to be taught from the Word of God. I boldly confess that my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, and I am about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. I'll never be the same. I'll never be the same. In Jesus' name. The Gospel according to Matthew, chapter number 1, verses 18 through 24. In the NIV version, it reads like this. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to a public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. Now jump to Luke chapter number 1, starting with verse 26. It reads like this in the New King James Version. "Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent to God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, 'Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women.' But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and he will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David." Verse 38. Then Mary said, "Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. The word of the Lord is already blessed. As I attempt to marry these two portions of scripture with the help of the Holy Ghost, I want to give you a different perspective on the Christmas story. And I want to challenge you to see this in a new light. The fact that both Mary and Joseph had to deal with a seemingly impossible situation where they didn't have any reference to really look back on because there weren't any other virgins having babies. And so I want to preach from the subject today. This don't make no sense, but I trust God. Is it all right if I use that double negative, Reverend? I had to say it how I feel. And this don't make no sense, but I trust God. Let us pray. Father, we bless your name and we thank you for this time of divine proclamation. We pray even now, O God, that you would encompass this, your servant, that you would use this feeble flesh to plant the seed of your word in the spirits of your people. Oh God, I declare this house and everyone in it good ground, that when the seed of the word goes forth, that it will take root in our spirits, that it will spring forth to produce not just good fruit, but good fruit that remains. Transform our lives because we are here to hear your word. Speak now, O God, for your servant hears. In the mighty matchless name of Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. This don't make no sense, but I trust God. Advent season is a time when we celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ into this world. It is a very holy and sacred period on the Christian calendar, filled with joy and music and celebrations. But have you ever considered this story from a purely humanistic point of view? Have you ever put yourself in the place of Mary and Joseph, contemplating what your response would be if you were facing the circumstances that they had to face? Would you have responded to the situation of the Immaculate Conception with the faith that Mary and Joseph demonstrated? Or would you have responded in a different way? Ladies, can I talk to you for a second?
Yes, sir.
Imagine if you were Mary, a young girl on the precipice of adulthood. She's engaged to her boo, Joseph. And you're eagerly awaiting and anticipating the beginning of a new life together with your husband to be. And then an angel comes to you and announces that you are pregnant with a child. conceived of the Holy Spirit. And this child that you are pregnant with will be the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Now, I know that if you were Mary, the first thing that would come to your mind would be, wait a minute. I know how babies are made. And I know that I haven't done what was necessary to make a baby with Joseph or anybody else. You know that you and Joseph are merely engaged and have not gotten married nor consummated your marriage. And you also know, being a good Jewish girl, that there are consequences to women at that time that were found pregnant without a husband. And I can imagine that after getting over the shock of the angelic visit and the strange announcement, your response may have been concerning this situation. This don't make no sense. Don't make no sense. Now, brothers, can I talk to you for a second? Imagine you were Joseph. You saw a young girl named Mary from around the way. You wooed her for months and for years. And after dating for a while, you went to her father and you asked for her hand in marriage. And her father said, yes, I agree. And then you went to Mary and you got down on one knee. You presented her with a ring and you said, Mary, my boo and my beloved, will you do me the honor of being my wife? And Mary, excited young girl, said, yes. And there were tears and joy, and you begin to make all the arrangements, Joseph, to begin your new life as a married man. And you were excited about taking Mary as your wife and building a home together. But one day Mary came to you and she said, Joe, we need to talk. She says, see, what had happened was... an angel came to me, Joe, and that angel told me I'm pregnant, but not the normal way. This child that I'm carrying is conceived of the Holy Spirit. I'm sure that if you were Joseph and you found yourself in this situation and circumstance, after you got over the initial shock, a swell of anger may have come up in your spirit and hurt, and then you would declare, probably loudly, this don't make no sense. This miraculous story of the birth of our Savior is one we celebrate. But I believe that there is more to the story that we can glean. I believe that this is not only a story that we should celebrate, not just during the Advent season, but every day of the year. But I also believe that this story can serve as an example to us of a lesson of faith. Somebody say faith. Let's begin with Mary. The Bible says that in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. That means he was in the lineage of the King David. And Gabriel was sent to Mary to proclaim to her that she was favored among women and would conceive a male child of the Holy Spirit. And this announcement was confirmation of what the prophet Isaiah said when he declared, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel," Isaiah 7 and 14. Mary understandably was stunned, and she asked Gabriel, "How can this be? How can this possibly happen? Because I'm still a virgin." An angel responds to Mary, "The Holy Spirit will overshadow you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God." Gabriel doesn't stop there. But in his effort to convince Mary of the impossible, he gives her further proof to confirm that God is going to perform a miracle in her life. The angel also informs Mary, said, "Listen, Mary, not only this," as if that wasn't enough, "now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing is impossible for God." Mary may not have had a point of reference for a virgin ever giving birth, but the angel Gabriel gave her an example of God moving in a manner that she was familiar, making barren women fertile. Undoubtedly, Mary had heard the stories of barren women being made fertile by the power of God. And when God wants to do a work in our lives that doesn't make sense, sometimes we must reference a miracle that God has already done in our lives to encourage our faith to believe for what God is doing right now. Although Mary may not have fully understood, look at her response. "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Even though Mary doesn't fully understand what God is doing, she submits to the will of God. And this isn't an easy submission. We don't really dig a little deeper into what Mary was consenting to. Mary understood that if she was not married, but she ended up pregnant, that she would not just face social shame and being an outcast, but it was the possibility that because of Jewish law, Mary could be stoned to death. And yet, in all of this, Mary said, "Lord, I'm your servant. Let it be according to what you said." Mary's faith in God was so strong, and her relationship with God was so personal, that she didn't need any more convincing for her to yield to the will of God for her life. If you're taking notes, this is my first point I want you to remember from this little Sunday school lesson. We must build such a close relationship with God that we trust him even though we don't understand what he's doing. Church folks used to, well, they still say at certain churches, we need to trust him when we can't trace him. God says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declare the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. God can't comprehend, we can't comprehend all that God wants to do in our lives, but those that have cultivated a close personal relationship with Jesus Christ recognizes his voice and are obedient even when it doesn't make sense. Scripture declares, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. John 10 and 27. This week we were talking in Bible study, and we're learning John chapter 14, verse 21, where it says, whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to him. It's not enough just to come to church. It's not enough just to hear the word of God. But the scripture says, if you hear the word of God and you have God's commandments, if you love him, you'll follow. Even when it doesn't make sense. Now let's consider Joseph's story. Joseph was a good man. He was a good brother trying to do the best he can when God interrupted his mundane experience to perform the miraculous. Joseph was told that Mary was with child, and he thought he only had two options: divorcing her quietly as to not subject her to public shaming and possible stoning, or he could have publicly shamed her. If this happened to some of us would have jumped on social media so quick. We would have been posting on Twitter and Instagram, Snapchat, and TikTok the story before it even. It'd have been all around Inglewood and ShopRite and everywhere else. Y'all never believe what Mary did to me. But Joseph, watch this, didn't say a word. Joseph only thought he had two options until the Lord presented him with a third. The Bible says while Joseph was sleeping, the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Once Joseph was given clarity from God, he was obedient to what God said, even though it still didn't make sense. This second point I want to make, Jesus, help me. Write this down if you can, and I hope you get this in your spirit. When we don't understand what God is doing in our lives, it's best to be quiet.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
When we don't understand what God is doing in our lives, what God is doing in our midst, it's best to be quiet.
Hallelujah.
Now, let me clarify. That doesn't mean that we can't ask for clarity and wisdom. Because we know that the scripture tells us that if we lack wisdom, we can go to God and he will give us wisdom. And he won't hold that against us. I'm not talking about talking to get more clarity. But many times when we don't understand what God is doing, we speak our minds when we should be seeking his face. I knew I wasn't going to get a whole lot of amens there, Jesus. Many times when we don't understand what God is doing, we speak our minds when we should be seeking his face. Joseph kept his mouth shut. Didn't tell nobody. Could have spread it all over Nazareth. Could have went off. Could have got on the phone and said, y'all never believe what is happening to me. Could have gotten angry and ran Mary's name down in the whole community. But Joseph, being a good man,
hallelujah,
kept that mouth shut until he received instructions from the Lord, not from Rashid, not from Pookie, not from Josephus, and not from Shaquita. You know, some of us get our wisdom from Shaquita. Joseph kept his mouth shut till he received instructions from the Lord on how to handle the situation. And because he kept his mouth shut until God spoke to him, it demonstrated what kind of character Joseph had. Sometimes when we open our mouths in times of uncertainty and we think that we're going to get somebody else, a lot of times God will use that time not to reveal them, but to reveal your character. Look at your neighbor, because y'all getting a little quiet on me. Look at your neighbor, smile at him, and say, neighbor, when you don't understand what God is doing, now do this. It was because of the obedience of Mary and Joseph that we can celebrate Advent, or the birth of our Savior today. Imagine how this world would be if Jesus was never born. Y'all think the Orange Menace is crazy now. Y'all think that things are going crazy now. You think that folks in your life are acting crazy now. Imagine if there was no rains because of the mercy of God. We would be in a messed up situation. But the obedience of Mary and Joseph in the situation, it didn't make sense. And to some, it still doesn't make sense. The Not only did it produce the Savior, but it gave us an example to follow when we find ourselves in situations when God is asking and requiring some things of us that just don't make sense. Understand that in those times where God doesn't make sense, in those times where God doesn't give us all the gory details, in those times where God doesn't share everything with us, but he requires us to step out on faith anyhow and watch me fill in the pieces as you go. In those times when God is requiring us to give him and to exercise the faith that we have, it is important that we be obedient in those times, not just for us, but like Mary and Joseph, their obedience is resonating with us even today. My last point is this, and I'm almost done. Y'all can go home and get ready for Christmas. Our obedience, saints of God, is going to impact others. Our obedience is going to impact others. What we do now is going to echo for generations to come. Amen. Whether we are obedient or whether we are disobedient, it will affect our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and great-great-grandchildren. It will affect this community for generations to come. And so what will our choice be when God requires something of us as the Ebenezer Baptist Church that doesn't make sense? What are we going to do? Are we going to be obedient? Or are we going to be disobedient? Either way, it is going to affect generations to come. If we are not obedient in this hour, our great-grandchildren may not have an Ebenezer Baptist Church to come to. I don't know about you, but I'm trying to follow the example of my Savior, who is obedient to the Father, even unto the cross. He was obedient to the Father in every aspect of his life. I was going to hoop, but I ain't hooping today, Kelvin. I need to teach today. And so what we going to do? Y'all don't mind if I slip into Ebonics. That's all right. Y'all still understand. What we gonna do as a church family? Are we gonna be obedient to God and be the disciples that God has called us to be? Are we going to build an evangelistic ministry here on this corner where we are not afraid to get out of these four walls and get out there and bring the church out there? Are we going to be fearful of what might happen or who we might encounter? Or are we going to be faithful and fearless and say, it doesn't matter what we face and encounter out there, if God be for us, who can be against us? understanding that God has given us power to be his disciples, not just in the church, but in the city, in the county, in the state, in the nation. Are we going? To be faithful when we don't understand what God is doing? Are we going to seek God's face instead of run our mouths? Are we going to trust him even when we can't trace him? I don't know, because I can't make the decision for you. I can only make the decision for me. I know that I'm trying to work on me. I'm trying to yield more to God for me. I'm trying to study his word so that it changes me, so that I can then pass on what God has given me to you. But whether you are obedient or not, as for me and my house, I have to serve him. I don't have a choice. There's no alternative for me. I don't know what else to do but be obedient. I can't go back out there in the world, and I don't want to, because I almost died out there. I'm going to be obedient. And if you're going to be obedient with me, stand and rest on your feet.